Please subscribe the channel and hit the bell icon for the future uploads. Hello everyone. In this part of the video, we are going to discuss the concept of cruelty. Now, as far as this concept is concerned, while discussing the concept of divorce in various religions, we have already discussed what cruelty is. But while discussing that, as far as answer sheet is concerned, you are supposed to write only one or two paragraph or one page, and that's why we have discussed only a portion of that concept. But a cruelty concept is much wider than one page, and that's why this special video is created to understand the concept in better way. So what is cruelty? Cruelty is nowhere defined. Even Supreme Court and various high courts have time and again has discussed that to define cruelty will be improper. Why? Because cruelty to one person differs by cruelty to the other, and that's why it is not proper to define cruelty in a perfect sentence. Still, to summarize the concept, I have tried to define the concept of cruelty into a behavior of a spouse which renders the other spouse impossible to live with that spouse. That kind of behavior can be termed as cruelty. And now what behavior falls as cruelty depends upon person to person, family to family, and society to society. Cruelty, a behavior of spouse which makes the living of the other spouse in matrimonial life impossible. This cruelty can be mental, physical, or financial or economic. So it is not necessary that the cruelty has to be actual physical cruelty, like beating a spouse or slapping a spouse or pushing a spouse or actually hitting the spouse. It can be mental, it can be financial. And now we will discuss each and every concept as far as mental cruelty, financial cruelty, and physical cruelty in detail. Cruelty, mental, physical, financial, or economic. This mental cruelty concept is also a very wide concept. So what can be cruelty to one spouse depends upon the upbringing of that person. So let's take few examples to understand this concept in a better way. Let's take a couple wherein the husband is telling the wife that she is a fool, or she does not understand the practicalities of life every day, every moment of her life. So in this scenario, if every time the woman is pestered by the husband continuously that she is fool, she is fool, she is fool, then that act of the husband can be treated as mental cruelty towards that wife, because morally she is feeling down every time husband utters such kind of sentences. Similarly, if the husband is telling the wife in such a way that to demoralize her or to humiliate her in front of the other people in the house, or to diminish her personality in the entire house, that behavior towards such spouse also can be termed as mental cruelty. This concept is very wide. So what can be mental cruelty to one spouse depends upon facts and circumstances of various other cases. Let's take an example where the husband is living in adultery, or the husband is not giving physical pleasures to the wife when the wife demands it, the husband is ignorant. Or let's take an example where the husband is not speaking to the wife at all. In all these three scenarios, mentally that wife is deprived from the love from the husband, and this can be termed even as mental cruelty towards that wife. Let's take another example. If the husband is having extramarital affair, he is not having physical relations with that person, but mentally that husband is involved in someone else. And due to that, he is not spending quality time with the wife. He is not sharing many things with the wife. And in that scenario, for that wife, there is a vacuum as far as husband is concerned, as far as emotions from the husband is concerned. And still in this scenario also, we say that it is a mental cruelty by the husband towards the wife. Similarly, a wife also can inflict mental cruelty to the husband in various other scenarios. If the wife, by her acts or actions, every time telling the husband that husband is somewhere less, or somewhere that husband is below the dignity of that person to live as husband with that spouse. For example, if the wife is a class 1 officer and if that husband is working in a lower post than such wife, the wife, if every time is telling the husband that, see, I am better person than you, or I am in better position financially or in curricular aspect than you, or I am better educated than you, and every time if such wife is telling the husband in such a way, that also can amount mental cruelty to such husband. So what amounts mental cruelty or not depends on facts and circumstances of each case and a proof rendered to support such facts and circumstances. So this is the aspect as far as mental cruelty is concerned. This concept of physical cruelty also is not set in fixed terms. A positive act or a negative act, both acts and actions, can be considered as physical cruelty to the other spouse. What is positive act and what is negative act? Meaning, actually doing something physically, and that is positive act, and negative act is not doing physically which the person is expected to do. Both the things can be termed as physical cruelty towards one spouse. Let's take examples in both the scenarios. As far as doing something is concerned, if the husband is actually beating the wife or slapping the wife or forcing himself physically over the wife to satisfy his physical lust, we can call it a rape, but in matrimonial offense we call it physical cruelty on the wife. So these kind of things also can be physical cruelty. Also similarly, if wife is actually scratching the husband or beating the husband or throwing utensils on the husband unnecessarily, can be termed as physical cruelty inflicted by wife towards the husband. But what are the examples of not doing something and still it will be cruelty to someone? Let's take a case where husband and wife are married with each other, and at the first night they had physical relations, but after that either the husband or the wife have stopped having physical relations with the other spouse, and there is a constant refusal to have physical relations. Now here the physical relations part is not done by one of the spouse, so here it is a negative act. In cohabitation, normally husband and wife are supposed to have physical relations, but if the other person is not doing it, and that act of not doing or not keeping physical relations with the other spouse can be physical cruelty to the other. It is physical depravity of not having physical relations also is a physical cruelty upon that person. And that's why a physical cruelty or actual physical cruelty can be a positive act or a negative act as well. Now, financial cruelty is also one of the factors to be considered by the court. If it is a duty of the husband to go out of the house to earn money and to maintain the entire family, and if he is not doing his duty, thereby financially depriving the spouse or wife, or in a case that both husband and wife are working, husband is also working, wife is also working, husband is giving entire his income in the family, but wife, as far as her income is concerned, she is saving the entire income and doing many other things but not giving the income to the husband, or not doing anything from that income towards the family. In that scenario, the second example was financial cruelty by the wife on the husband, and first example was financial cruelty by husband to the wife. If the husband stops giving maintenance to the wife granted by the court, that also is a financial cruelty inflicted by the husband on the wife. Similarly, in a position that the wife is earning, and even though she is earning, she has not disclosed this fact in the court, and she has asked for maintenance amount, and due to which the court has granted maintenance amount to be paid by the husband to the wife. Husband is regularly paying that amount, and later on it is found out that the wife was actually working. She was not required maintenance, but to harass the husband, she has claimed that maintenance from the court. In that scenario also, it is financial cruelty inflicted by the wife on the husband, wherein the husband can take this recourse on the ground of cruelty. While considering this mental, physical and financial cruelty by the court also has to see whether the acts and actions mentioned by the petitioner are either normal wear and tear, or the allegations are actually grave and weighty. This is also a burden cast upon the court to see what is normal wear and tear and what is grave and weighty allegation. So let's take a few examples. See, whenever there is a couple, husband and wife, residing in one house, there will be some kind of quarrels between the two. And these quarrels can be a trivial acts, Like if the husband, for an example, let's take that for one night he is very tired, and if he says to his wife that today I am not in the mood to even speak with that person, we cannot say that the husband has inflicted cruelty on that wife. If he has worked for the entire day and if he is feeling tired, and because of that if he is expecting some kind of space from the wife, that act cannot be termed as cruelty, but it is normal wear and tear happening in everyone's life. Sometimes wife also can say to the husband that I am too tired right now, please don't speak, I want some peace of mind. And in that scenario, it is normal wear and tear. Or fighting on trivial issues will be very much normal wear and tear, and it is not cruelty. But at the same time, certain grave and certain very weighty allegations of cruelty only to be considered by the court. There is a specific case law by the Honorable Supreme Court which states that allegations of cruelty should be grave and weighty. The instances of cruelty should be grave and weighty, and then and only the option of cruelty to obtain divorce is available with the parties. And what grave and weighty is depends upon each fact and circumstances of case. Let's take an example. There is a one couple who is about to get married, and before the marriage itself, the wife is of suspicious nature and she is over possessive towards the husband. And every time if the husband receives a call of someone, and if that someone is a lady, the wife suspects that that lady is having some kind of relationship with her husband. This is before the marriage itself. The husband reprimanded, rather here we say not husband but groom, because they are yet to get married. So the groom reprimanded the bride that this behavior is not good, and then he will not get married with her. But then the behavior continued, and that groom became used to such kind of suspicious nature from the wife, and he rather started enjoying the possessiveness shown by the wife, and he started neglecting it. And if after knowing this behavior, after knowing that the wife is of suspicious nature, she used to call the colleagues of such person that whether the husband is really having an affair with someone or not, she is constantly checking and keeping an eye on the husband, and still if the husband has married with that spouse, it means that this behavior, this suspicious nature is perfectly normal towards that person. And then the husband, such husband, after marriage cannot come to the court and say that see, I want divorce because my wife is of suspicious nature. He was knowing of this fact that this person is of suspicious nature, and after knowing this fact, he got married with that person. So for him, this act of suspicious nature becomes normal wear and tear. Apart from this suspicious nature, if that spouse does something else which can be termed as cruelty to that husband, that will be a separately entire different scenario. But if that is not the case and she is only suspicious, then on this ground such husband cannot seek divorce from the court, because that act will be normal wear and tear for that husband. So what will be normal wear and tear and what will be grave and weighty will depend upon facts and circumstances of each case, where the parties are coming from, what are their backgrounds, how socially they are. Every factor will be considered by the court while deciding whether one act is grave and weighty or whether it is normal wear and tear. The most important aspect while pleading cruelty in any petition is that instances of cruelty has to be specified in different paragraphs by mentioning time, date and place of the occurrence of that instance and chronologically. So what does court expect? The court expects from the parties to write first of all instances in chronological order. So instance that has occurred first in point of time should come first, and likewise the later instance shall come later on. Similarly, each and every instance one has to write a date when that instance has occurred, time as to when that instance has occurred, and place as to where that instance has occurred. So all these three things, place, time and date, all these three things are very much essential while mentioning each and every point of cruelty. Bombay High Court for that matter has framed rules, and every other High Court also has framed similar rules as far as rules regarding petitions to be filed under Hindu Marriage Act, Special Marriage Act, Divorce Act and likewise. And in each and every rule, if you go through each and every rules set out by the Bombay High Court or various other High Courts, there is a specific provision that in the petition there has to be each and every offence of cruelty to be mentioned as per date, time and place of its occurrence, set out in different paragraphs in chronological order. So This way, if the cruelty is pleaded, it gets easier for the court to understand as to what has been happened and what is the gravity of it, and whether the act of cruelty, how it gradually increased or decreased, and what is the behavioral pattern of one person over the period of time towards the other, to decide whether that act is cruelty or not. Each factum of alleged cruelty to be mentioned with date, time and place of occurrence in chronological orders set out in different paragraphs. Also, the most important topic as far as cruelty is concerned is condonation of cruelty. Why I said most important is because there is a specific section in Hindu Marriage Act and in other acts as well, wherein a specific provision is made, that is the duty of the court to see whether the acts of cruelty, as has been alleged by the petitioner, whether he has condoned it. And as far as this aspect, the court also frames the issue while mentioning in the issues that whether the petitioner has condoned the acts of alleged cruelty mentioned in the petition. And therefore, this becomes the most important topic. There was a case, Dastane versus Dastane, happened in Pune Family Court, which went up to Supreme Court of India, wherein this concept of condonation firstly evolved. What is this concept of condonation? Condonation means forgiveness. So if by acts of the spouse, if that spouse has forgiven the other, after forgiving that person, whether such person can go to the court and say that I want divorce because my spouse has done this thing, after that person has forgiven the other spouse? Of course not. And therefore, this concept of condonation has been evolved by Dastane versus Dastane case. The entire case, Dastane versus Dastane, which is very important as far as the topic of cruelty is concerned, is mentioned in my description box. Please go through the case law, please read it. I know that case law is very big, but if you go through the case law in entirety, you will understand the concept of cruelty in better manner. So Dastane versus Dastane set out for certain principles as to condonation. And what act can be condonation is, if for example a person has physical relations with the other, having physical relations can be termed as condonation. This will be towards the acts and actions. Or if the person literally says that okay, I forgive you, or the person says that okay, whatever happened has happened, but now on we'll move on in life and I still love you and I want to live with you, this also will be condonation. So these kind of things can be treated as condonation. But what is the object of condonation? First and foremost object is to forgive the spouse. Second object is to continue the matrimonial relationship so that that person has to be given another chance. And to give that person a chance, this forgiveness is there. So second important object is to give chance to the other person. And third and the most important object of condonation is so that the other person shall not repeat the acts of cruelty as has been alleged before, so that after forgiving that spouse, that person should not repeat the same mistakes again and again. So all these three objects are incumbent in the condonation of cruelty. This is a very wide concept. To understand it better, I will say that it is better to go through the entire case law as to what has happened in that case and how the concept of condonation evolved, and thereby amendment was carried out in various enactments and condonation factor was included in it. Condonation of cruelty, object of condonation, to forgive, to give other spouse a chance, to not to repeat such acts, effect, to start the matrimonial life afresh. Does it mean that once a party is condoned of the acts of cruelty, after that whatever acts to be done by the party will be also condoned? And the chronology is no. If you go through the Dastane versus Dastane case, it also states revival of cruelty. So condonation washes away and cruelty revives. And when that happens is, we have seen the three objects of condonation, and the last object was that the other spouse should not repeat the acts of cruelty. If the other spouse repeats the acts of cruelty or does some fresh act of cruelty, the entire condoned cruelty will be revived and the spouse can seek divorce on the fresh cruelty and the various other cruelties which the spouse did in the past, which that spouse has forgiven. So on entire cruelty, the spouse can go to the court and seek divorce, But while doing it, the person has to plead that, see here, I have condoned the act of cruelty, but here the cruelty was revived by the further acts, and therefore I am coming before the court by various other grounds of cruelty available for me. Even though I had condoned it, by the acts and actions of my spouse, the cruelty reinstated and the condonation washed out, and therefore I am entitled to seek divorce. This has to be pleaded in the petition itself. And if it is pleaded in the petition, we will say that that petition becomes a perfect petition of cruelty, which can definitely hold some kind of merit in the court depending upon the proofs submitted in the court. The revival of cruelty, any other act or similar act after condonation. To conclude this topic, cruelty is not defined by any court or any act, but it is a conduct of one party towards the other which makes the other party continuing the matrimonial relationship impossible. It can be mental, physical or financial cruelty. Also, normal wear and tear is not cruelty, but it should be grave and weighty. Also, the court has to see whether the act of cruelty is condoned and whether after condonation it is revived or not, and whether such act will amount to cruelty towards that spouse depending upon the facts and circumstances, and whether while mentioning the acts of cruelty, the person has mentioned it in different paragraphs with the date, place and time of the occurrence of the offense of cruelty. Same video in Marathi language is also available, link of which is given in the description box down below. If you have liked the video, please give a thumbs up. Video on various topics are going to be uploaded on YouTube. Please subscribe the channel and hit the bell icon for the future uploads. Thank you.